Welcome to the video. I'm doing my best to make a video that's worthy of your time and attention. So it has to be very, very good. We've heard that enlightenment is not the enlightenment of a person. It's the end of a person. No more person to be enlightened. We've heard that. But consider it this way. It's the end of a belief in a person. No more belief in a person. That doesn't mean there isn't anything there. Just because the belief in something ends doesn't mean that there isn't anything there, okay? So it's not a nothing. From the standpoint of belief, it's a nothing. There's a nothingness. That's from the standpoint of belief. It's not really true that there's nothing there. It's not really true that there's no being there, no aspect of being there. It's just that there's no belief there. Belief in anything at all. There's zero belief, no more need for belief. What is doesn't need belief in it to be what it is. So there is isness there. And we are all aspects of that isness. So when we talk about the disappearance of the cell, of the me, the person, the disappearance of the universe, the disappearance of all this stuff, it means the disappearance of the belief in a universe, a belief in a person, etc., etc. That doesn't mean the universe disappears. It doesn't mean the person disappears, the self disappears. No, none of that. The belief in all of that disappears. And its place is the overlay of unconditional love. And you're experiencing the self, the person, the universe, overlaid with unconditional love. And experiencing that, that is nothing separate from that unconditional love. A total overlay of it. So this should be helpful to try and quell some of the fears that people have, saying that I'm going to lose myself, I'm going to lose who I am, and all that stuff. No. You'll let go of the belief in what you are, but the belief in what you are, that is what you want to let go of, because it believes that you're impermanent. It believes your destiny is to die. It believes you're unstable. It believes you don't have any isness. Believe, okay. You're impermanent. That is the belief in yourself and everything. That is the belief. So we don't need to get rid of the person, the universe, and all this dream. We need to see it overlaid with unconditional love, that which is permanent, that which is not dependent on belief. Okay? Unconditional love is not dependent on belief. Isness is not dependent on belief at all. So it seems difficult to let go of the story of what you are, etc., etc. You just have to let go of the belief in it. Just let go of belief altogether and just step. It's like an exchange. Exchange belief for unconditional love. That is the focus. You're still here. The world is still here. Everything is still here. Except that the experience is now the isness of unconditional love, equally overlaying everything simultaneously. So it gives, it's like an accurate symbol of isness, so to speak, an accurate reflection of isness. Needing nothing external to be completed. Needing no belief in it to be what it is. Being untouched by any belief. So you might say enlightenment is simply abiding in the experiencing of that which doesn't need any belief in it to be what it is. So something is abiding in that. Our experiencing is abiding in that. Experiencing. Really, what we are is experiencing. That is our identity. In the isness of reality, there is experiencing, and we are that experiencing. Even if someone says, well, there is no self, there is no person, there is no, there's nothing, etc., there's still an experiencer. There's an experiencing of that. They can say, well, no one's experiencing it. Well, there's an experiencing of no one experiencing it. You can't do away with it, with experiencing. Why try to do away with that? It's not needed. You don't need to do away with it. You see, the belief in enlightenment, the belief in disappearance of the universe, the belief in all that, is just the way that belief tries to disguise what its real purpose is. It tries to say, look, we're working on enlightenment here, folks. Whereas the purpose of existence is working on trying to manufacture power, a new power, power of destructivity, power to destroy reality. That's actually the purpose, the agenda of existence. But we try to hide that from the Prime Creator and say, no, we're just working on unity consciousness. We're just working on oneness. We're just working on enlightenment. We're just working on getting free of delusion, all this stuff, you know. Now, the real step is to step out of belief into unconditional love, the I Am presence of isness as presented by, as reflected by unconditional love. That is the real step that has to be taken. And so you're still the experiencer. Right now you're experiencing non-experience, you might say. And so we go to experiencing non-experience, to experiencing isness, reflection, a perfect reflection of isness. Still the same experiencer. The one who is experiencing is still there. It's just what is being experienced is changed, been made, swapped. Swap the experience of non-experiencing for the experience of unconditional love. But the experiencer is the same. Experiencer remains. Why try to get rid of the experiencer? And as far as the oneness thing, well, by experiencing unconditional love overlaid over all belief, over all belief, everything that arises in belief overlaid by it, we realize that this overlay is all one. It's not some more here, less here. It overlays everything as if it were just one. You see, no differences. That's the vision of oneness. That's the remembrance of reality. Reality gives everything to all aspects of reality. Perfect freedom to all aspects of reality. That is the oneness. There is no one having more and no one having less. All powers of reality apply to all aspects of reality. So if you want to experience oneness, experience unconditional love, step out of belief into what is beyond belief. See, belief cannot see, experience unconditional love. Belief can only believe in belief. That's it. And the power of belief. And there isn't any power. Belief is belief, but there's no power of belief. I mean, what does belief do in reality? Nothing. If something doesn't do anything in reality, how can it be said to be a power? So we're working on this simple step, realizing we cannot bring reality into belief. It's impossible, because belief cannot recognize it, reality. Belief believes that everything is changeable. So even if you tried, if you could bring reality to a belief, it wouldn't believe in it. It'd say, this is an illusion, and it's certain to change. That's what belief would say. Belief would say, you can't trust this. It's certain to change. It's an illusion. It's a fabrication. It's a trick. It's a trap. That's what belief believes in, has to. So belief cannot experience anything, because only reality can be experienced, and belief denies reality. So it's really not experiencing anything. It's just believing that it's experiencing. That's it. It's just believing that it is. It's not. And so we're waiting to experience. We're waiting to experience, and we're not experiencing. We're experiencing non-experience. And we keep hoping that belief will finally believe in the right thing, and we'll be able to experience. Never will happen. Will never happen. So we have to step beyond belief. We won't lose ourselves. We won't lose anything except belief, which is nothing. Nothing but and this is dissolving the dweller on the threshold of being able to look at these finer points calmly. Right there dissolves the terror, you know, the terror that we're going to be lost, gone, nothing there. There's no belief there. We don't need belief to be what we are. We don't need belief to experience. Experience is not based on belief. The experience of non-experiencing is based on belief. And we're tired of that, right? And we're tired of pretending to be spiritual, when in fact all we're doing is waiting for belief to finally click and be catalyzed into some power, that we can use that power and coerce, threaten the Prime Creator to change reality and make us Prime Creator, at which point we believe then we will be experiencing even greater than ever before. So we're waiting for that, and as we wait, we put on all sorts of spiritual costumes. Write all sorts of spiritual books, hold all sorts of spiritual conferences, give all sorts of spiritual therapies, do all this stuff. The one thing we don't do is we don't step beyond belief. Because why? Belief won't believe it. There's no validation from belief. To step beyond belief. There's no validation from it. And so we all want validation from belief, from the world of belief. Why? Because we invented belief. And we feel that belief is like our creation. And so we want our creation to at least validate that we are now beyond belief. It cannot do that. It will just say that you're crazy, or that you've had an episode. It wants to pull you back out of your episode. We had some mystical experience, and we need to study it now. Need to write a book about it. Need to hold a seminar on it, a retreat. Maybe give, you know, teaching about mystical experience. Maybe get a new name, a spiritual name, all this stuff. Integrate it into belief. In fact, you don't need to do any of that. That's not the goal. The goal is the realization that what we are doesn't need any validation from belief whatsoever. So it's not seeking any validation from belief. It doesn't need it. Whether belief, whatever belief says pro or con, doesn't matter. You know, it's like someone who's talking gibberish. It doesn't matter. Sometimes they say yes, blah, 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 yes. Sometimes they go blah, 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 no, blah, 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 no, blah, 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 yes, blah, 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 no, blah, 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 yes, blah, 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 no. What does it matter whether they say yes or no? The one speaking gibberish is just, you know, just throwing, you know, throwing paint against a wall, just, you know, and saying, ah, oh, what a work of art. It doesn't matter. Belief will say all sorts of things. It'll say everything. It doesn't have any meanings, meaningless. Praise and blame from belief are equally invalid. How can we accept praise for from that which is insane? That which has no idea of what it is praising. You know, how meaningful is that praise? It's not meaningful. So we can get to that point where we no longer need to pay any attention to belief. Whatever it says, pro, con, doesn't matter. We don't even listen to it anymore. Tune it out. It gets tuned out. Still there. Still there. Everything's still there in the world. Just tune it out. It's tuned out. Because you realize there's zero validity in any of it. There's no belief in reality. Reality is not sustained by belief. It is not validated by belief. Beautiful evening tonight. Wow. You know, the fall is coming. And it won't always be this wonderful, these days. There are certain events coming. Maybe even an October surprise, and certainly a November decision, and maybe in December something also, who knows. But it's a great time to step beyond belief. And if we do, we realize that we're still here. We're still here. We're experiencing this fragrance of remembrance. We might think, oh, wait a minute, we're not enlightened, or we didn't get rid of something, or the self, the person, you know, didn't get rid of it. There's no need to get rid of anything. You just go beyond the belief in anything. Go beyond belief to knowing, to actual experiencing. Who cares about who's the experiencer and all this kind of stuff? It's nonsense. It's not important. That there is an experiencer is enough. You don't have to label it or say what it is or say what it isn't or anything like that. That's not important. It's what is being experienced that is important. The fact that experience is taking place is important, because experiencing is not taking place in the belief system. This hypothetical scenario we call existence, there's no experiencing taking place. There's belief in experiencing taking place. But it's fake. It's fake experiencing. It's not a real experiencing. It's actually depicting a loss of experiencing. You get these bodies with all these, you know, the senses, and then gradually the senses diminish. You can't, and you can't. Your experiencing degrades very badly, and then finally, at death, your experiencing vanishes. You know, it's like, ah, you lost your experiencing. You see, Because that's the purpose of existence, to develop the power of loss. To prove that loss is possible, that the reality can lose what it is, can be destroyed, can lose its isness, can lose what it is. So we have this pseudo-experiencing, and then we lose it, and we think, aha, you see, there is that power, there really is that power, we just haven't figured out how to use it yet. It's like it's there, but we haven't figured out how to, you know, pull the trigger on it. It's like some tricky mechanism. It's kind of like that. I mean, belief believes a lot of stuff, but let's say we believe that there is this power of destructivity over reality. And we're desperately trying to figure out how to activate this power, you know, how to pull the trigger, how to push the button. We can't quite figure it out yet, but we're sure we will figure it out if we just all stick together and work together and support one another. We're all sure that we're going to figure out how to press that button. There's some kind of, you know, something tricky we haven't figured out yet. It seems kind of simple, but, you know, some cosmic adjustment needs to take place. There needs to be an alignment with the cosmos. We need everybody to do it all together. You know, we're not sure exactly how to push that button. And we're all constantly working on that, trying to figure out, you know, waiting for some genius to find the answer. You know, people, when I was young, people came to me and said, you got what it takes. You can figure it out for us. We've been waiting a long time. The older people said, we've been suffering and waiting a long time, you know, and we can't get it, but you just might be the guy that can do it, that can figure it out. And I was like, you know, it's kind of like, you know, that doesn't sound right to me, you know. And so there was this flattery that goes on when you come into the world. To bring truth, you get flattered into losing track of what you came for, because people will say, maybe you're the one, and you could be, you almost probably are the one, and all you need to do is tell us how to push that button down, and kaboom, you know, we got the power now, we've activated the weapon that is going to destroy reality, and now we have the leverage we need to force Prime Creator to change reality. So you hear that from these older people. The older people are saying, wow, you're really spiritual. You got all these psychic gifts and you're so bright. And surely, you know, you might be the one, or if you can work with others to help them figure out how to do it. I'd say, how to do what? And they'd say, whoa, how to be enlightened or something. But that's a code, that's a disguise. By enlightened, they say, how to figure out how to push that button on the super weapon. Meaning that once we activate the super weapon, then we'll get everything we want. And they just, you know, call it enlightenment or something like that. They say, yeah, you're the one who's going to bring and save us all. You could be the savior. Meaning, figure out how to activate that super weapon. And then God will be forced to change reality, and we'll be Prime Creator, and then we'll be saved from all this, you know, suffering. Not. So you get this trip put on you when you come into the world, and you have what it takes. You are not functioning from belief, you're functioning from knowing. I used to function from knowing. I just knew whatever I needed to know, I just knew. No process. And everyone said, wow, you might be the one that can save us. And what by that code word for activate that super weapon. And so you get confused and you get flattered and all this stuff. All these people are sitting there, you know, they're like, we're just waiting to anoint you. All you gotta do is just, you know, just give us the answer. We're tired of waiting. We thought we could do it, but we didn't. But now here you are, and we know you can do it. Come on, we're pulling for you. That's what they do. We're really pulling for you. You can do it, you can do it, you can do it. We've been waiting, come on, come on, come on, come on. So I'm thinking, you know, what is it, what is the problem, you know? This is really weird. Because it's all in code. They use all the spiritual terminology, and you think they're talking about what you came to explain or show, But it's all, it's, and then you try to say, well, do you want enlightenment here? And they say, no, not yet for that. First, you just have to, you know, just show us. They don't say what, but they say, we just need that, you know, come on, we need that enlightenment from you. We need that. They keep saying we need something. What is it they need? Was it an activation code for that super weapon? They think that the super weapon has got some activation code, you know, like on software, you know, ACQ143KW, Z86321, you know, activation code. And they keep trying, you know, they've got all these computers working on trying to figure out this activation code, which is really why all the computers are here, even though we think, oh, these are wonderful things that are there for us. No, we're trying to crack the code. Everybody's trying to crack the code, thinking there's this code. What is the code? And since I just knew everything, just intuitively knew, they thought for sure I must know the code, right? So they say, just, you know, tell us the code, you know, mean, just, you know, whisper in our ear, you know. And I'm just like, what code? You know, code to what? They wouldn't say what. They said, no, you let us worry about that. You just tell us the code. And you tell us the code, we will be saved. I said, got a strange idea of salvation. I don't know any code. But they're convinced of it, you know. Why? Because again, they think that there is this super weapon somewhere, and all they need is the code to activate it. And once they activate it, they'll be able to aim it towards the Prime Creator, you know, and say, Prime Creator, we're gonna push these, boom, we're gonna push these buttons. If you don't change reality, I look like Larry King, don't I? Change reality and make us Prime Creator. I'm just lacking my suspenders here. Maybe I'll put on some suspenders, but I don't have any anymore. That's what they mean by being saved. So I'm like wondering, what the heck is going on here? And people are, you know, weird. This is really weird. But it's not so weird anymore. It's very crystal clear. For some reason, it wasn't clear enough to me exactly what the problem is. It's, you know, there is no super weapon. Therefore, there is no meaningful code. You can search for code your whole life. You can have all the supercomputers in the world crunching numbers and spinning out codes forever. And if there's no super weapon to apply them to, what good is that? Complete waste of time. All these computers are a complete waste of time. All the technology is a complete waste of time. So it's never going to give the answer that we're really seeking for. Of course, no one's honest enough to admit what we're seeking for. We're seeking for that code to activate the super weapon, which we believe must be somewhere. Must be. Has to be. Otherwise, all this would be complete folly. So, no, belief has to say, no, it's somewhere. The reason we just need the code is when we find the code, suddenly we'll see it. You know, we'll activate it, and we'll see it. We'll have it. Right now, it's invisible to us. We can't see it because we need the code. Get the code, it suddenly will materialize, manifest. We're just trying to manifest a super weapon. So then, you know, put God in the crosshairs. Say, okay, here's the deal. You change reality, make us Prime Creator, and we'll leave reality alone. We won't press this button. So that's what's really going on. This gives us much firmer foundation for choosing unconditional love. When you understand that people will think that you've got the code when you choose unconditional love, and you just seem to know, intuitively know everything, they'll say, this one's got the code. But they're going to be real careful, you know. Say, how do we approach this one? Got to figure out, you know, all sorts of approaches, very clever approaches, like, we're just here for the darshan and our sadhana and our satsang, our inquiry and all this stuff, but they're listening very carefully and say, maybe he's going to slip us the code, you know, maybe. That's probably, he just wants to make sure we're worthy enough, we know how to use it. So the gurus always complain, like, everybody comes to me, they're not really interested in salvation. What's going on? That's what's going on. People are coming for the code. But they'll never admit it. If you bring that up, say, what, are you crazy? I'm coming for liberation. You know, I'm coming for a realization. I'm not coming for any code. But that's a superficial thing. That's window dressing. And by pointing that out, you automatically go beyond the window dressing, you see. You can say, yeah, I am here for the code. And then we can say, okay, great. Now we've got a foundation to work on, which is one of honesty. And now we can look and see, is if there is no super weapon possible, there's no way to harm reality at all, how could there be a super weapon? Let's use reason. If reality can never be harmed or changed in any way, which experientially I know is a fact, then how could there be a super weapon? What kind of weapon could there be? There couldn't be any weapon at all against reality. So whether you have a code or not makes no difference. And if there's no weapon, what good is a code? There can't be any code either, really. How can there be a code to nothing? Is that really a code, or is it just meaningless waste of time symbols throughout all the symbols? If there's no software, you have these letters and numbers, is it really a code? If it's not a code to anything, is it a code? No, it's not. So once you're honest, then you can start breaking the whole thing down. Breaking the whole thing down. Then you just look at it and say, wow, how easy is that, you know? So really, honesty is the key thing. Knowing that reality can't be changed is also key. You put those two together, honesty and knowing that reality can't be changed, then you can start just easily sifting through and saying, oh, wait a minute. Yeah. There isn't any super weapon. If there's no super weapon, there are no codes. And if there are no codes, what in the heck am I doing waiting for someone to come up with a code? You know, waiting. We all expect there's some kid in his underwear in a basement somewhere, you know, who's almost cracked it. Some hacker somewhere who's almost cracked the code. And we're all kind of waiting for that, aren't we? Waiting for the code cracker. And the problem is we wait in vain. And as we wait, we're about ready to have our heads busted. Because again, the purpose of existence is to generate loss, keep generating more and more trauma, more and more loss, and try to manufacture this power. That's also part of the dynamics of existence. Everything arises so it can be ground, knocked back down. Everything's propped up to be knocked down. Everything is given us so it can be taken away from us. So as we're waiting for the code to be cracked, thinking we're almost there, any day now, we end up getting in the crosshairs of history, getting in harm's way. So it's a dangerous thing to just be waiting for the code to be cracked. Because it never will be cracked. It's our heads that are going to be cracked. And that too is done in a sort of ritualistic way, which is supposedly supposed to generate a code. You know, if you crack enough heads, maybe that's the code, right? that's what the thinking. How we just have to sacrifice this number of people and this, all this, you know, and all destroy all this and this and this and this, and that will do the activation. Yeah. So there's all different types of things we're trying to do to activate it. You can look at it many different ways. Activate what? A non-existent super weapon? There is no super weapon against reality. There's no weapon at all against reality. So there can't be any codes. All this sacrifice is useless. All these rituals are useless. All these attempts, you know, at code cracking are useless. trying to generate that, you know, the right code, trying to come up with the right code. It's a waste of time. So the guru doesn't have any code. But of course, no one believes that. That's the problem, right? Belief, there's belief again. Belief doesn't believe it. Belief has to believe there is a super weapon, and there is a code, and there is a way to activate it, and then there is a way to truly threaten reality. Belief has to believe there is a way to truly threaten reality with destruction. Therefore, from there, that's its premise, and then it starts reasoning from that premise. And using logic from that premise, saying, well, there must be a way, and if we can't see the way, we must think that it's hiding from us. It must be there, just we can't find it. And if we have to figure out a way to find it, and if it's invisible, we think there must be some way to manifest it to us, you know, or there must be some code that we use to, you know, activate it, make it functional for us. Right now we can't really figure it out. We think we see bits and pieces and parts of it here and there. We're trying to kind of piece it all together, you know, this big universal puzzle of how do we piece the universe together and get it all right, you know, like it's now a super laser that can be aimed at reality. And so we're all working on, you know, unifying the universe. So what is that? Unifying the universe so it can turn into this super potent laser weapon and zap reality. And of course, we're so tired of waiting, we don't suffer fools gladly. So, and since nothing works, we presume it's because somebody's messing up. And so we take a very dim view of those people over there, you know, they're not working hard enough. They're loafing. They're screw ups. You know, better take the whip to those people. But better yet, let's invade them, and instill some discipline in them. So you have all these conflicts in the universe because it seems like there's too many slackers around. That's why we're not succeeding. It's all the slackers' fault. And of course, then you have those, you know, we say, those gurus. Look at them. What slackers? They're teaching everybody to be slackers. How terrible. Awful stuff. Gotta get rid of that. We need everybody to be very disciplined and work real hard and follow the leader. We've got this dear leader here, and we know this dear leader is the one who's going to lead us to find the code. No question about it. So let's everybody follow the dear leader. And no criticism. Oh boy, criticism's really bad because that's rendering, it's getting in the way, okay, of efficiency. And of unity of purpose and all that stuff. No, we can't have that. We cannot have criticisms. No. That's harmful. That's hurtful. That slows everything down. Everybody got to be on the same page, pulling the same direction. And only in that way are we going to finally get this job done, you know. Because we've been working at it for a long time. And we're tired of working at it. We don't want to, we're not going to put up with any more slacking. You know, so there you go. And there you have the drama, the melodrama, the soap opera of existence, which is if you've been watching the soap opera enough, you realize it is just this crazy, crazy soap opera. You couldn't write a soap opera that is so melodramatic and nuts if you just look at everything that keeps unfolding in existence. My gosh. It's really something. The whole totality of existence. You know, I've been studying it, kind of say, what in the world is going on here? You know, and finally, I've been able to see it. But if you don't know what it is, you just are lost in this melodrama, just saying, wow, you know, what a long, strange trip it really is here, and it keeps going on. And what, you know, wow, are we. Somehow we're not quite successful in some way, it's not happening, you know, for us yet, and we got to make it happen. And what do we need to make it happen? You know, We need more better advertising. We need better leaders. We need better management. We need more willing workers. We need less criticism. We need less disputes. We need everybody to just get along. We need to stop, disliking that group or disliking that group. Or, let's all, join in together. And by doing that, we're going to succeed. Or at other times, we say, no, the slacker, forget it. People just naturally slackers, and so forget about them. Let's have an elite group, take care of it, and forget about the slackers. And other times, it's, no, everybody's important. Bring everybody in, and that'll do it. So it just keeps changing because nothing works. If nothing works, what else is there to try except change, right? If nothing works, if the code never activates the super weapon, then what else is there to try except change? You have to keep trying to change. Or you keep hitting your head against the wall too. But that doesn't work either. So it's inevitable that you're going to have change. And the universe just keeps changing, trying different stuff all the time. And none of it works. So, there's frustration. There's anger. There's hostility. We're feeling like we're our lives are incomplete because somebody there doesn't like us or is not with the program, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You can see how this soap opera of the universe just, like a fish swimming around. You never know, where the fish is going to go, like a fish in a tank. That's what it's like. All searching for a way to find that weapon and activate it. And sometimes we think we found it, we just can't activate it. Other times we think we have the activation, we just can't find it. And sometimes we think, we got it, we've got the parts, we just have to piece it together. We got the parts of the super weapon. One's over in this galaxy, another's over in the planet in this galaxy. You got all these planets, there are little screws and nuts and bolts, the planets. And then we just piece it all together, we think, assemble it. We just need an assembly team. And once we assemble it, we're going to have this super weapon. And we're going to have our super laser. And look out, Prime Creator, once we get that, that's everyone's, deep, deep, underlying, hidden hope. They won't admit it, though. Won't admit it. Say, oh, no. We're just working on Unity Con just because we love God. Something like that. Well, God is here right now. Complete. No need to do any searches for it. How much closer do we get to now in the future as opposed to right now? Is the future going to get us closer to now? How can we get closer to now? How is the future going to bring us closer to right now? That's the question. How is the future going to get us closer to right now? Isn't it that each day, now is still right now? How do we get closer to it? So all the time, how does time get us closer to right now? Passage, how does the passage of time get us closer to right now? We keep saying that it is. That's a self-deceit. That's a way to hide our true agenda. We say, we're working on getting closer to now. How do you get closer to now? Through time. Now is right here, right now. The past is the past, the future is the future, and right now is right now. So these are the kinds of things that we take a look at. We don't have to say, aha, We can look at it and say, yeah, okay. That's good to look at that. Interesting. Very interesting. So all this stuff, you know, is grist for our mill, and we make the bread out of it and say, ah, eat the bread, and say, that's good. That's very nourishing. We're just waiting for a code. See, that's a different way of looking at it, right? Kind of skirts around the ways we've been used to looking at it, where some, you know, our belief has been able to defend against that, because it doesn't bring up the full situation, really. It doesn't, because it doesn't talk about what the purpose of existence is. You know, that's always just as, you know, ignored, as if it's not important. It's all important. It's all important. Because from knowing that purpose, the whole thing, the whole situation becomes very clear. And the fear is taken out of it. The uncertainty and the fear is taken out of it. You can see the deception of belief and how it's put all these you know, facades of spirituality up. Simply facades to hide what's going on in the back room. In the back room, there's all these hackers, and they're trying to figure out what the code is to the super weapon. Meanwhile, in front, there's all these people working on unity consciousness, which is really in the back room. They're working on how to piece together all these pieces of the supposed super weapon. We think the super weapon is all the pieces are been spread out all over the universe. They're all over the place. And each civilization's task is to find a piece of that super weapon. And eventually each, you know, group, all these groups, all the universe will each have their little piece, and they'll put them, the real assemblers will put them in a back room. And they're all working, they'll assemble the pieces they've collected from all over the universe, and then we'll have our super weapon. Meanwhile, you have all these people up front talking about the no self and the no realization and the freedom and the liberation and the oneness and unity, and they're all, you know, working on that, because they don't want God to know what's going on in the back room. And God is just laughing and smiling, and, you know, there is no super weapon, there is no assemblage of anything in the back room. They're probably playing poker back there, you know, probably got a card game going on. And all this play acting of spirituality, you know, is you know, that's funny too. It just, we're great actors at that. Great actors. Most of the spirituality of the world is just acting. It's just acting. It's just putting up a facade. The abidance in unconditional love, that carries a certain something with it. It carries it, and it's unmistakable. It's not an act. It's not an act. You can't really fake that. You can't really fake it. Some have tried, but it is really farcical. Really, something to almost, if you weren't caught up in it, it would be quite a funny farce. But being caught up in it, it's not so funny at all. We can take just, you know, some quiet time like this, you know. You don't need to, you know, stitch words together nonstop. You can just pause. Just pause. It's like the end of a song. You don't have to jump into the next song. You can have a little pause to let the first let the other song sink in. Get ready for the next song. So we have this song and dance in existence as a song and a dance. That's Maya, the song and dance. All the while pretending that we're trying to bring about unity consciousness, what we're really trying to do is we're trying to assemble all these parts for the super weapon. But that's deep, deep, deep secret. That's top secret. Top secret. Which is why it's so difficult to figure out what's going on in this world. Because nobody ever told me this, okay? I had to see it for myself. It's top secret. And and no one will admit to it, really. Very few. Although some have seen it. I've noticed that there are some that have seen it, and they say, wow, wow. And then they just realize nobody will believe them if they say anything about it. So they bury it again and, you know, end up adopting a spiritual facade, which is, you know, very, very sad. You know, if you look at those spiritual actors, underneath they're desperate and they're sad. And sometimes this starts leaching through, you know, they can't keep the facade up. And you see the enormous sadness within them and the gloom and just the weight. You know, of this facade. It's just horrible. The strain, you know, on the actor, it can be severe. And it's, you know, some of them may have seen it and they just thought, believe me, nobody's gonna believe me, you know. Well, I believe you, absolutely, for sure. I know, absolutely, crystal clear. And God is not the least bit upset about this at all. He just has a good chuckle, you know. It's pretty funny. We're trying to search throughout the whole universe, trying to grab all these pieces. I think that the super weapon somehow needs to be assembled. No, you know. Assembly required, you know. We got this big package. Big package is the universe. You know, here we are with this big package. We're reading the instructions. It says, assembly required. And we say, oh boy. We open it up and there's like, whoa, all these pieces all over the place. Or we think like it's an Easter egg hunt. All the pieces are all hidden all over the place somewhere. And we have to, you know, find them. We have to find these pieces. We're on this, what, vast scavenger hunt here in existence. Vast scavenger hunt. And everybody's pretending, no, I'm just going there for a vacation and just kind of hang out. No, not true. They're deep down, they're looking. You know, everywhere they go, they look, is it there? You know, where is that piece? Can I find it? You know, got the archaeologist dusting off the bones. And they're pretending to be really into this, you know. But what they're really doing is they're digging down and they're hoping to find a piece of the super weapon. Of course, nobody has really found it yet. People think they might have. They don't know. Got all these museums and, you know, stuff's inside it. And people go to museums and they're looking. Ah, yeah. Wow. But deep down they're saying, I wonder if, you know, the part of the super weapon is here. It's this unspoken, there's an entire unspoken milieu of existence, of this seeking for these pieces of the super weapon, also trying to find code and all that. It's going on constantly, completely out in the open, but it's like the emperor has no clothes. Nobody's going to say anything about it. We have this dreadful determination to assemble this weapon. And to admit that that's what we're trying to do is completely taboo. Because to admit that this is what we're trying to do, opens it up for discussion, saying, okay, you know, how have we done so far? Is there a super weapon we can find? You know, is reality vulnerable? You start asking those questions. Whereas if people just remain completely determined that their only purpose is that they have to succeed at this, they're not going to even question anything or whether they can succeed. That is out of the question entirely. And so no one brings it up. It's become, you know, it's complete cultural, universal taboo to say what the universe is really engaged in. So when you want to come into this world, this universe, and explain, nobody's going to listen because it's completely taboo to listen. Which is why sometimes teachers have to laugh quite a bit, because they want to, you know, come on, be honest. And if people, no, they keep saying, no, I want to be enlightened first. I don't want to be honest, I want to be enlightened. And they say, well, first be honest, and then we'll figure out what enlightenment really is. You know? Enlightenment is again, stepping beyond belief, because there's nothing in belief. There's nothing there. There is no super weapon. There's no activation. There's no super weapon. There's no way to change reality. This whole thing is simply an exercise in futility. So belief is really nothing. It has no power. So we have to be clear of, you know, what is quote unquote enlightenment. Getting clearer and clearer about it. The reason why teaching hasn't been effective in the universe, very effective at all, is because there's been this lack of honesty about what the purpose of this universe is. That's the problem. That is what I've seen. That is what I've been working on my entire life. What is really the problem here? And the problem is there's this lack of honesty about what the purpose of the universe really is. And until you have that honesty, you're just going to go around in circles, for the most part. Some might have this honesty and they never say it, but they might somehow, you know, step beyond belief. That has happened. But the taboo on saying anything about it is just universal. A universal taboo. I've been able to get past this universal taboo, but it's extremely difficult. Extremely difficult. Because nobody will agree. You know, and if you're looking for agreement, you know, you're not going to do it. Almost nobody. Some might, you know, deep down say, yeah, maybe. You might get some maybes. Might get maybes, which is okay. But it's almost like people need to go at it almost like hypothetically, a hypothetical then a hypothetical, saying, okay, for hypothetically, let's say that is the purpose. And, you know, and then they can look at it that way. They may not just say, yes, it is, definitely. They might say, well, I'm not sure, but let's suppose that it is, you know. And then that enables them a way to look at, if it was true, then what would enlightenment be? You know, what would freedom be? What would liberation be? What would it be like? And how easy would it be? And what does it entail? That kind of thing. But as long as we keep that taboo in place, we're really, really in trouble. Because our purpose will be to continue to hide what we're trying to do even more. We think, uh-oh, God might be onto us, you know. You know, you get someone in the world who talks about, yeah, you're just trying to assemble a super weapon, and people say, oh my gosh, this is terrible, you know. God seems to be might be onto us, and they'll try to stop us. So then people get together and say, what do we do? And then people decide, you know what, we need a spiritual teacher to get us going and get us really spiritual. And they say, ah, okay, so somebody's found, you know, you can do it. You're a spiritual teacher. And so people get really into spirituality And then they can then say, look, God, we're not trying to assemble a super weapon to destroy you. We're trying to be enlightened. Look at everything we're doing. You know, we're really into it from A to Z. We got our beads. We got the flowers in our hair. We got the right clothes. We got the mantras and the yantras. We've got the yoga, and we've got the dance, and we've got the encountering, and we've got the chanting, and we got the drumming, and we've got the tantra, and we've got the singing, and we've got the all the accoutrement, you know, possible. We've got the prayers, and we've got the buildings, and we've got the pilgrimages, and we've got the retreats, and we've got the meditation and the contemplation, and we're all really, really into it. But the question is, what are we into it for? We're into it to try and calm God down so God thinks, oh, I must have been mistaken. They weren't really trying to assemble some super weapon. They're really trying to realize unity consciousness. So you that's what you get. That's what you get. You don't get anybody stepping on beyond belief into unconditional love. You get this song and dance of spirituality. But the truth is that God is not in the slightest bit unsure about what's going on. God knows from the very beginning. God knows the purpose of this dream, this hypothetical scenario, is to try and develop a weapon, a power that can destroy reality. From the very beginning, God knows that's all that it is. And God realizes it's impossible. So, case closed. It's already been closed. Final judgment's already made. It's impossible. So, choose a different idea. God is not paying any attention to our song and dance of spirituality. Other than, you know, have a good laugh, you know, not at our expense, but just, you know, a farce is pretty funny. And it's a loving laugh. Come on, come on. Come on, just fess up, you know, be honest, just repent, say, yeah, of course we're trying to assemble this weapon. Of course we're trying to find a way to activate this weapon. That's all we're doing, really. Everything else is just a red herring we're trying to drag across the path. We're trying to fool God. God is as simple as can be. It's completely obvious. God knew from the very instant, before we even chose the idea. God knew we would choose the idea and what the idea was, the idea of trying to be prime creator, and that this gives rise to this hypothetical scenario, which we imagine there's a way there must be a way to get this super weapon, super threat that can destroy reality. All of that is completely known. Crystal clear. Impossible not to know it. So, we don't need to keep doing the song and dance of spirituality to try and distract God. God already knows. God knows there's no super weapon. So how can we be assembling anything? We're just, again, God's standpoint, we're just there playing cards. We're not doing anything. We're just wasting our time. We're just kind of hanging out on the bayou, you know, eating jambalaya and just hanging out. Not really doing anything. So, yeah, we're just hanging out and we're waiting. We're waiting for some backroom boys to crack the code, you know, and assemble it. But there's no assembly going on. No assembly going on. No codes being found. Nothing is happening. As far, you know, as the purpose of the universe, nothing's happening. We believe something is happening because belief has to believe it's all taking place. It's all purposeful. It's all meaningful. It's all happening. There's nothing happening here. Which is why you can step beyond belief into isness, an overlay of it. How difficult is it to overlay nothing? Nothing's happening. You know, you have all this belief. It's all equally untrue. It's all equally nothing. It's all equally meaningless. So if we look at the situation, you know, from this standpoint, it puts us on vastly more stable ground, really. as I've spent my life evaluating all the teachings, all the teachers of this world and other worlds and universal teaching, all this stuff, and just trying to see how can you get on better ground so it becomes much, much easier. And that's the way, what I see is it is to be honest about what the purpose of existence really is. And it's completely blatant, you know, really. Completely blatant. If you're willing to be honest, you see it. You realize it. You say, of course, of course, of course. Of course, it all fits. This song and dance of spirituality, you know, you look at it and say, what in the world are they doing? That's what I say. That's what I feel. I'm looking at this conference that's coming up. And it's got so many spiritual teachers and presenters that, you know, it took a long time to scroll through them. Oh my gosh. And the bios and everything. I'm looking at them, I say, I don't see a single one there that is awakened, that has gone beyond belief. Not even close, and nothing there. Say, what are they doing? You know, what's going on here? Well, it's the song and the dance. The song remains the same, and the dance continues. And they're saying, look here what's taking place on planet Earth. Wow! There's some heavy-duty spiritual stuff going on here. I bet you even God is paying attention. At least in, for instance, Christianity, they have the principle that we're all sinners, which is pointing to the fact that we're all engaged in this effort to destroy reality. And that's actually much better grounded than spirituality. Much better grounded. But it's somehow lost its juice. You know, it's lost its juice. But maybe it never had enough juice, I don't know, but at least that's in there. It's in there. That there's something we need to confess to God. There's something we need to repent to God. That is true. We just need to say, God, this is what we've been doing. We've been trying to figure out a way to destroy you because we wanted to threaten you to make us prime creator. And God will say, yeah, well, I know, of course, I'd always known this. And God will say, great, okay, so now that you know it's impossible, we can't do it, what are you going to do now? Well, how about just choosing a new idea, stepping beyond belief, and you see, that's it. So the what has gone out of fashion in today's world is any honesty about the purpose of existence. In the past, you know, teachers would get up there and preach hellfire, you know. If I put on some kind of a beard, I might be able to do that too. And, you know, you're miserable wretches, you sinners. You're going to be fried in the fires of hell, you know. And, you know, you're completely debased and wicked and all this stuff. And what they're trying to do is just saying, hey, you know, be honest, be honest, be honest, be honest with God. And they say, repent, go to God and say, God, I'm an idiot. I've been trying to develop this power to destroy you, and it's gotten nowhere. And I've been trying to trick you, you know, into thinking I was doing something else, that I was really spiritual or something. And that was all a facade. It was all nonsense. Yeah, I know that. You know, God will just say, of course, yeah, great, that's great, wonderful. Finally, finally, finally. You trust me enough to say these things, because you realize no harm, no foul. You've never done anything. There's no weapon. There's no threat. There's no threat. Where is the fear? If there's no fear, where is the anger? And if there's no anger there, what must be there? Love must be there. Unconditional love must still be there. So God is just, and Jesus said, God is unconditional love. That is true. Always, because there is no threat. There is no anger because there is no threat. There's unconditional love because there's no anger. There's no anger because there is no fear. There is no fear because there is no threat. There's no threat, because reality can't, what is real cannot be threatened. There is no power that can, because all power was created by the Prime Creator, and there's no power of harm to reality that was created by Prime Creator. Therefore, any belief, so therefore, if we want to entertain the notion, we have to simply believe it, rather than know it or experience it, because it cannot be known or experienced. It can only be believed in, which is why we step beyond belief. We'll realize, there's only unconditional love there. Only unconditional love. So, you know, the traditional teachings had a lot of meat on them, you know. A lot of elements were correct. And well, the tragedy of the times is people who feel capable of putting up a more clever facade are carrying the day right now. A clever spiritual facade. There were a lot of so-called super teachers who presented some kind of super facade, and people, you know, wow, they left silent and said, wow, maybe I can learn how to put up a super facade too. And that's kind of generated a situation where instead of those all important elements, realizing God is unconditional love, we have been confessing, we've been trying to find a way to destroy reality, and we want to be reconciled, we want to give that up, we want to repent, we want to exchange, choose a new idea. All those things, those basics, have been replaced with better facades to better trick God, supposedly, you know, mislead God. Like we're really one with something, you know, really almost one with something, God, and isn't this great? And to better disguise what's, you know, what we're still trying to do. And nobody talks about what we're trying to do. No, we're not sinners, you know. No, we're wonderful children, you know, of God who are just trying to perfect consciousness, you know. So we've lapsed back in, you know, we've regressed. Everyone thinks we're in a spiritually enlightened time. We're not. We've regressed. We have regressed. Unfortunately. And when you regress and refuse, and you're dishonest and putting up a facade, spiritual facade, you will then twist things around backwards, and you will claim that, no, you haven't regressed, you know. It's the one who is holding on to those old, worn-out traditions. They're the ones who have regressed. That's regressive. We're progressive kind of thing. They got it backwards. The so-called progress of the times is really regression. It's simply spirit belief saying, wait a minute. We don't need to confess anything to God. We can come up with a better distraction because we've almost figured out how to assemble the super weapon and activate it. We've almost figured out how to manifest it through some kind of magic. And so don't give up yet. Just put on a little better act. And so what happens? You get these super gurus come into the world, and they're like super actors. They put on a super act. You know, it's kind of, they're so good. It's like, you almost like want to applaud them, even though you know that it's all just an act. It's such a well done act, you know. You almost kind of want to go, wow, you know, very nice, you know. Wow, just like, hey, very clever, very well done, you know. It's like watching like a guitarist playing something you can't stand the song, but the dexterity is so fabulous. You almost want to say, wow, that's really terrific dexterity. So we got these very, very prima donna actors, spiritual actors, who, you know, presented such sophisticated facades that we everyone kind of paid attention and said, wow, you know, this is possible. You know, putting on a better facade is possible. So then we've been working on that collectively with the planet, how to put up a better facade. More spiritual sounding phrases. We're getting better and better at it. All these people are channeling ascended masters, and ascended masters have all these wonderful spiritual phrases, my beloved children, who we are entering, you know, and then they go on to just dripping with honey, you know, honeyed phrases, and we're getting so good at that. And God is just, just laughing. Come on, just be honest, and then choose a new idea. It's that simple. There's no harm in being honest. You see, there's no harm in moving the facade aside. You don't need the facade. You don't need to be tricking God, even if you're going to confess to God. We're afraid, like, God might be a little bit angry. So we want to go to God and say, God, look how spiritual I am, and we're waiting to see if God recognizes our spirituality. And then we think, it's kind of like a naughty kid, goes to the parents and tries to, and done something wrong, and they realize they're getting in trouble. So they study real hard, they get A's on their report card, and they go to their parents, and say, look at my straight A's, and by the way, I did this thing, it was kind of bad. I'm sorry I did it, but look at this report card. So we're trying to get a spiritual report card. We're trying to get straight A's so we can hold it up to God, so when God sees it, we've been trying to destroy God, God will say, that's terrible, I'm so angry, and say, wait, God, look at this report card. And God looks at it and says, oh, I'm so pleased in you. I've been working on unity consciousness and all this. Isn't that great? God will say, okay, I forgive you. It's not like that. There's nothing to forgive. There's nothing to forgive. God is not thinking like, how can I forgive a spirit for doing this? No. Nothing ever happened. There is no super weapon. Nothing. Nothing, 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 nothing ever happened. So what is there to forgive? Nothing. Why? How can you forgive nothing? No, God has just said, look, reality is the way it's always been. It is what it is. It's unconditional love. It's eternal delight. It's invulnerability. It's everything. It's always been. Welcome home. Welcome home. That's all. Welcome home. Welcome home. There's no other. There's no discussion. God's not going to be looking at your report card, your spiritual report card. You don't need any spiritual report card. God would just say, what is that for? And you say, and then we think of God doesn't recognize the spiritual report card here. We can't tell him about this. We want God to say, oh my gosh, look at that report card. That is fabulous. But God just says, welcome home. And you say, uh-oh. I better not confess, what I've been up to, because God, God's not interested in my spiritual report card here. Say, yeah, God, I lived a good life. I was nice to people, to women and children and animals. And I tried to get rid of some pollution. And I worked on some green energy solutions. And I went to some workshops. I went to some retreats. I studied some spiritual literature. I went to see some spiritual teachers. And I had a mystical experience once. And got a good heart, like to paint, poetry, and I'm a pretty good person. And God will say, what are you talking about? Welcome home. Here, how does unconditional love feel? That's what God will say. How does unconditional love feel? It feels pretty great, doesn't it? You say, wow, what do you mean? What about my report card? What about my resume? What about my resume? You don't need a resume. God's not looking for a resume. He's looking for honesty. So I've said all these things. I've been saying all these things. I've known all this for a long time. God's never been angry at me. Never, never got the slightest impression that there's something wrong with saying this. Okay. No. So don't be worried, of course. Again, there is no threat to reality. So what can God be angry about? He knows we've been trying to disguise what we're up to, and it's like a parent looking at a child, knows exactly what the little child's up to, and just kind of smiling and grinning, saying, when are they going to realize that I'm onto them, right? When is the child going to realize that the parent is onto them? And they can both have a laugh together. It's like that. It is like that. So welcome home. Welcome. How does unconditional love feel? That's all. We say, hey, it feels great. God says, yeah. Sure does. It's always felt this way. How does isness feel? We say, ah, perfect. God said, yeah, it's always been perfect. Always will be perfect. So honesty is the best policy. And we have, in our rush towards sophistication, thrown out the baby with the bathwater, most unfortunately. It's out of fashion to say, yeah, I need to confess. I need to confess. And the problem is in the church, the Christian church, Catholic Christian church, confession has been made somewhat superficial. I mean, it's because people are afraid to confess to God what they really want to confess. So instead we confess our quote-unquote sins. You know, like we say, I'm sorry, God, I have sinned against you. You know, I've done this stuff. I haven't been a good person. I've had these thoughts in my head, you know, materialistic thoughts and violent thoughts and lustful thoughts and greedy thoughts and thoughts of cheating and lying and stealing and, you know, may have done some things. I had some anger towards someone and all this kind of things. And we confess that stuff. But that's not the confession that should be talked about. That's not the confession. That's like a facade again. It is a facade of confession. God's not interested in those confessions. But they don't help us. But what we need to confess is what the purpose of existence is. Say, God, I want to be prime creator. I chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator. And therefore I want to find a way to force you to change realities and make me prime creator. And I've been trying to hide this effort. I've been trying to assemble a super weapon that can destroy reality. And I've been trying to hide this effort by all this pretense. You know, and, you know, it's been kind of a ridiculous thing. I'm tired of it. And God will say, yeah, isn't that great? Yeah, you find that's great. Okay. How does unconditional love sound to you? How about stepping beyond belief? That's the confession. That is the confession. Not, you know, this piddling stuff about, you know, how we treated somebody else and all this kind of stuff. So, you know, the sacrament is there, but it's not being used properly. The sacraments are there. They're just not being interpreted, not being used properly. So, of course, people attack the sacraments saying, you know, they're useless. Well, if you don't use them properly, you know, you open yourself up to that. And then you open yourself up to the flourishing of this sophisticated spiritual facadeness. And you start paying attention to those peddlers of this stuff, of the great actors and actresses who can, you know, put on the Ritz and put on the spiritual Ritz. And they have. They've done it, you know, and it's been quite a show, you know. It's like I said, you know, it's like you're watching some horrible, terrible horror movie. You know, you can't stand the content. But the special effects, it's like, wow. You're just kind of like, this is, how are they doing that? All these, you know, dragons, you know, hacking each other to pieces in fire. And all. And you say, this horror, I hate that. But how are they doing those special effects? Same thing with the spiritual facade, the expert actors and actresses. You know, you realize that they're off their rockers, you know. And they're not really bringing the true gospel to the world. And but they're so skillful at what they do, you just, you know, almost become taken in by the skill and overlook the content. And we're all vulnerable to that. It's tough. I mean, I saw through it, but again, we're enthralled by the skill. You know, we're just kind of like, wow. How are they doing that? You know, it's amazing. How are they able to be so believable, even though I know that they're not the real thing? How are they so believable? Because they're using belief. As long as we, you know, as long as we're attached to belief, we will be vulnerable to believing in belief, which, you know, is, again, not real. So the more honest we are, the less we're going to be tricked, the less we'll be enthralled by the skill of these actors and actresses. And the cat is coming by. Hello, cat. like a cat. How can they walk so softly? You know, like, wow. It's walking so softly. Amazing. You know. But where is the cat going? You know, no place. Hello, cat. Probably hungry. The cat's probably hungry. So you will find when you can get this out in the open and just see it, you'll feel like, my gosh, I don't have to go keep going through all this song and dance anymore. You know, put you on solid ground as far as taking that step beyond belief. At least you can feel your feet. You know, you feel your feet and you feel that you're on some solid ground. You feel like you can take a step, whereas before you feel all defeated. In a way, you can't feel your feet at all. You feel defeated. And you say, how can I take a step when I can't even feel my feet? You know. But when you see this and you see the situation as it is, as it really is, then you feel like, you know what, I think I can take that step. I feel like I can take the step. It's beyond thinking. You say, okay, I feel my feet. I feel the capacity. I feel like I can take that step. And the belief will say, you're depriving the world of a great potential, great code breaker. Or, you're depriving the world of a great potential scab. Or, you're depriving the world of a great potential spiritual actor or actress, you know. And I always will say, you're depriving, you know. But you're not depriving belief of anything, because belief is nothing. How can you deprive nothing of anything? You're not depriving belief of any success. The belief, has no success to give. So how can you, again, be taking something away from nothing? How is that possible? You can believe it's possible, but how is it actually possible? It's not actually possible, is it? So it's just, again, just more gibberish. You're not depriving existence of anything. Not depriving. There are no great code breakers because there is no code. There are no great assemblers because there is no super weapon. and there are no truly great spiritual actors and actresses, because what they're trying to hide doesn't exist. What they're trying to distract from is already perfectly known, right? God already knows it perfectly. And there are those in the world also can see right through it. It's funny. One of these great, great actors, spiritual actors, there was someone who saw, who could see through them, and they refused to acknowledge their existence. Of course. And I noticed that. I said, they're acknowledging the existence of all these other spiritual teachers, but there's one teacher they're leaving out. Conspicuous by the absence of this teacher, very conspicuous. I said, that's very interesting, because to acknowledge that would be acknowledge that what they were doing was just a facade, just an acting job. Oh, interesting. But God knows, you know, and we are one with God, so we know, deep down we know. Okay, but we're just kind of like, again, enthralled by this, our ability to spin all these webs of deceit and distraction, and say, wow, what will we come up with next? What kind of fake teacher will we come up with next? You know, it should be pretty interesting. Yeah, it'll be interesting fakery, but is that what you really want? or do you want to experience unconditional love? That is the choice. You can either go on with again experiencing interesting deception and fakery, skillful, sophisticated, interesting, or experience unconditional love. And so you ask yourself, what do I really want? Not what I want. We know what belief wants, but what do I really want? And I am beyond belief. So what is that which is beyond belief? What does that really want? Wants to experience, actually experience, instead of just believing that it's experiencing. It's not interested in all this fakery and facades, these floats, you know. You don't have to do anything about any of that. You know, you will feel like you're feeling more stable ground is all. Feel more grounded in the entire situation as it is. You feel more grounded in what is, as it is, and then more grounded in choice. More grounded in choice. You'll feel, hey, yes, I can choose a new idea. More grounded in that. And that is all important, to feel grounded in that, that you feel you can take a step beyond belief, where you're not, where there is that which is not dependent on belief at all for being what it is. Belief is dependent on belief, okay, but reality is not dependent on belief. So the feeling is one that you're not so scared of any teachers at all, any taboo at all, any guilt that you're somehow depriving existence of some kind of, you know, help. So there's no guilt there. There's no intimidation there. There's no confusion. So that's what means you're finding your legs, you're finding your feet. You're no longer defeated. You don't feel defeated. I don't feel so defeated, you know, by being able to get all this out. And recognizing when you're a genuine teacher, people will still think that you've got the secret for them. You know, the secret, and they just have worship you sufficiently so you'll cough it up. You know, you've got it inside you. Ah, it comes. And you know, you don't have any such secret. You don't have it. Maybe they think you've got the final part. You know, it's been all assembled, and you're the one. You've got the pin or the code. You know, you got to enter this code, and everything then will be full speed ahead. So you realize that's how it goes here. And that you'll be able to see through that. Just gently smile and laugh and chuckle, and then say, "Okay, come on, let's get honest here. Let's get real. Let's get real. Let's get real. Come on, let's get real about this here." And maybe some will, maybe some won't, for sure. So some will not, for sure, and some will. So again, you don't have to do anything at this point. Just feel. Just be quiet with yourself and see if you still have all those fears. Or you might be aware that, hey, I don't still feel so afraid right now. I don't feel like I'm someone who's going to be defeated. I don't feel like someone who's going to be delayed. I don't feel like someone who's going to succumb to guilt. I feel like someone who's going to go beyond belief. Yeah, you say, I feel like that is, I feel like someone who is going to, you know, like that. Just check in. And when you realize that, you realize, hey, that's progress. That's real progress. Real progress has taken place here. For me, too, absolutely. Because I was able to bring this subject up, the only taboo of the universe. I was able to spill the beans and present it to the entire world. And whoever wants to see it, it's there. So able to do that, knowing that that doesn't get God angry in the slightest bit. And doing it in a way I feel is a good way. And that's super helpful. Very, very good to feel the capability to, okay, you know, now full speed ahead. And it's a good time to go full speed ahead before any October surprise shows up. Okay? All right. That's it for this video. Very great.